And within the university system, no, I must place the unions in proper pathway for the students.
Hello and welcome to the program. Now, 8 months after South Africa's independence, that was in December of 1994, armed youth gangs in the Alexandra Township outside Johannesburg in Gauteng province destroyed the homes and property of some undocumented migrants and marched the individuals down to the local police station where they demanded that the foreigners be forcibly and immediately removed. That was the genesis of xenophobic crisis in South Africa. That small incident that was not checked promptly has now snowballed into the monster we now have in South Africa called xenophobia. In September 1998, two Senegalese and a Mozambican were thrown from a moving train in Johannesburg by a group of individuals, South Africans, of course. The group blamed foreigners for the levels of unemployment, crime, and even the spread of HIV/AIDS. In the township of Zandspruit in Johannesburg also, residents went on rampage, burning down shacks of Zimbabwean foreigners living in the settlement with the intention of driving them out of the country. Now, they claimed the Zimbabweans were stealing their jobs and causing crime. Again, that incident was not properly checked by the South African government. In 2000, 7 xenophobic killings were reported in the Cape Flats districts of Cape Town. Kenyan Kingori Siguri died in Tambo. That's after being attacked and shot. And in separate incidents, two Nigerians were shot dead in NY99 in Guguletu. That's Prince Anya, 36, who owned a restaurant in Sea Point, was hijacked with his wife, Gidi, and their toddler. And, of course, in Adam Taz Road, Bosig, and another town in Ndolumba Street in Langa, two Angolan brothers were trapped inside their house and burned to death. Now, they were in their house when it was set alight by several men who then ran away. The brothers, as we said, burned to death. By 2008, xenophobic attack had become part of the culture of the locals in South Africa. The people see other blacks as responsible for their poverty, unemployment, sickness, and even and every misfortune, I should say. And on May, of course, 11, 2008, an outbreak of xenophobic violence in the Johannesburg township of Alexandria triggered more xenophobic violence in other townships. Firstly, it only spread to the Gauteng province. After 2 weeks, the violence spread to other urban areas across the country, mainly Durban and Cape Town. But it also emerged in townships in more rural areas such as Limpopo province. The victims were called foreigners, referring to their nationality that's been non-South African and predominantly Zimbabwean and Mozambican. As a result, many houses were burned, 342 shops were looted, and 213 burnt down. Hundreds of people were injured, thousands chased away, and the death toll after the attacks stood at 56. Today, xenophobic attack has reached a level that the South African government is finding difficult to control. Many foreign nationals have accused even South African police of looking the other way while foreigners are being killed and their houses burnt. Arrest of the perpetrators are rarely made. The recent outbreak of attacks in South Africa now, of course, has placed South Africa, I should say, on the spotlight. The country now wreaks the wrath of the continent with its failure to address the issue. President Jacob Zuma, who condemned the attack, said, quote, we're not a xenophobic country. At the same time, we cannot close our eyes to the concern of the communities that most of the crimes, such as drug dealings, prostitution, and human trafficking, are allegedly perpetrated by foreign nationals, end of quote. Now, African countries like Nigeria, Mozambique, Senegal, Ghana, Zimbabwe, and others are speaking tough on the attack on their citizens. Presidential aide on diaspora matters, Abike Dabiri, has warned of dire consequences if the South African government does not reprimand its citizens and stop the unnecessary provocation of Nigerians. Now, the National Assembly is also sending a delegation to that country to meet with their South African counterparts to discuss the issue. Yeah, we're waiting for what happens after that discussion. And between Abuja and Lagos, we're seeing the number of protests grow. Different groups have been demanding tougher action from the government of Nigeria. Here is one such protest that happened recently at the Nigerian Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Abuja. Let's take a listen.
We want justice. South African authorities, you make sure that this time, if they didn't pay adequate compensation for every Nigerian life that was lost, they must pay. Every property, they must pay. If they don't pay, let them not come back. Those businesses that are seized by the Nigerian government will not be given back to them. Expropriation is a normal thing. It's a practice under international law. It may be hard, but it's a practice. This is a deserving situation for the Nigerian government to deal decisively with the South African authorities and the South African people. Call for a United Nations General Assembly session to address South African xenophobia. The evil of South Africa is thinking of high heavens, and Nigeria is not leading the way. Address it at the United Nations level. South Africa has not learned its lesson. It will happen again if we don't take these actions.
The government is taking up all measures with the South African authorities to ensure that the rights of those affected are well protected and an appropriate remedy will be secured on their behalf. So my coming here is to receive on behalf of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Minister of State and the Permanent Secretary, indeed the entire officials of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, your letter of complaint, which will be transmitted to the highest authorities, and we assure you that the authorities will take appropriate action.
Well, joining me now to discuss this issue is human rights lawyer and president of the Committee for the Defense of Human Rights, Malachi Ugumadu. And of course, I have Achikechu there with us, who is a human rights activist. Gentlemen, thank you very much for coming on the program. Let me start with you, Malachi. You saw the strong reaction of man there. I mean, the leader of that group. I mean, it tells you how Nigerians feel about this across the country. And then you see the response of the government official there. It just doesn't match.
Certainly, there is no corresponding ownership of the pain of the people abroad. I'm talking of Nigerian nationals in South Africa. It doesn't quite resonate. There's this pattern that is given that, first of all, the man who came to receive the letter is perhaps a junior officer in terms of the hierarchy. The commanding height of the Ministry of Affairs. That will put to question the premium that was placed on that kind of complaint. And it does not accordingly lie in his mouth to give the kind of assurance that it will be treated with dispatch as he promised. But I think that the major thing is to ask the question how we have come to this level, where we are treated with ignominy in the Committee of Nations. Now, it used to be other developed countries in the world. Today, countries that are otherwise known as lesser, countries in the African continent, treat Nigeria with ignominy, taking steps that clearly confirm that Nigeria has become inconsequential. And the fact that it repeats itself not once, not twice, goes a long way to confirm that assertion. And that question is valid, because if it is not answered, if it is not attended to, if it is not resolved, it is given that there will be a repetition of this manner of treatment to the African people.
Could we say one of the reasons why we continue to have, because as you said, it's not the first time we're having xenophobic attacks in South Africa, targeted at Nigerians, Mozambicans, Zimbabweans. Could it be that if the governments of these various countries, I mean, whose citizens have always been targeted, if they had taken tougher action in the past, maybe, the South African government too would have taken tougher action against us?
That question is very important, because in a sense, it addresses the first question that I raised. What should be the response of a country whose nationals are killed extrajudicially in foreign countries? Can a country such as Nigeria stop at the point where Honorable Abike Dabiri comes out, shows the resentment of the government, assures the populace as she did in the past that nothing will happen. Don't forget, the same woman, with all due respect, I mean, she's shown tremendous interest in issues of diaspora, was heading the House Committee on Diaspora. And I recall...
And when we had a similar attack.
And I recall that we've had series of such attacks, including, of course, the Tochukwu incident in Thailand or one of these Asian countries that was executed. You know, so before we turn it into a pattern, I am making the point that, look, the Big Brother Nigeria has multiple options on how to put an end to this level of transgressions, particularly bordering on the extrajudicial killing of Nigerians. First is to make the point that, look, anyone who goes to a foreign country and breaches the law of that country should face the consequence of that. That's on one side. Yeah. I mean, it's quite different. It must be isolated to this kind of xenophobic attack on our people. A country such as Nigeria should go beyond such avowals, such resentment, such disapproval, and take one or two steps, particularly when you have monitored the progression and found that there is no corresponding effort. As I speak with you, it is only the South African High Commissioner here, Lulu, who had made the utterances that are very that are not properly coordinated, as far as I'm concerned. We've not seen a former representation. We've not seen that commiseration. We've not seen a very public condemnation. The Zuma utterance, you thought, was more or less rationalizing, trying to characterize
exactly
what has happened. And then I come back to my point that what is the big deal in recalling, for instance, the Nigerian ambassador to South Africa, who has also shown to be operating peripherally? What does it stop us as a country to show that beyond our condemnation of what has happened, we are not ready to tolerate it again? To what extent can we summon their own ambassador here? Not the round table tea party thing they are doing, to specifically give us a concrete report of what has happened there and what the government intends to do, including, and I'm landing here, including, of course, a clear prosecution. I mean, it will be a serious, the feelings of Nigerians will be properly assuaged if, as we speak, those who have been arrested are arraigned already. Look, in criminal trials, you can amend a charge at any point of this. But we can't continue like this.
Atike, let me get your thoughts on this. What do you think? How should Nigeria go about dealing with this? Because it would appear the authorities would appear not to want to ruffle feathers, so to speak. Because, I don't know, President Zuma was here last year. And, of course, President Buhari also was in South Africa. And... after the 2015 attacks, we thought we had seen the last, and then this is happening, and it appears this is happening with more intensity than we saw in 2015. So what exactly can we do? What should the authorities be doing now?
Well, Nigeria and South Africa have had their own fair share of differences. Of course, you know, the NTMTN issue that made the public... that became a very public issue,
exactly,
violating the laws of this country, and the fact that in an unprecedented manner the Nigerian government, through its the relevant agency, slammed so much sanction or fine on that company. And then we've had also issues in the past with Nigerians being discriminated against in South Africa, and of course the Nigerian government expressing displeasure over that. I know that what is going on in South Africa goes against the grain of even the liberation struggle, goes against the grain of African solidarity. In fact, it undermines it in so many ways. I remember I was in this same studio when the second outbreak of xenophobic attacks took place. And we watched a clip of, I think, John Kufo, the Ghanaian president.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, very strong, very angry. You know, and he did not mince words about what was going on in South Africa. And so some months later, we are back exactly to the same situation. And so what that would tell you is that the right thing was not done in terms of showing the South African government the serious displeasure of African countries that their citizens continue to suffer.
Because the South African government has not handled this properly.
They have not, you know, and they have shown gross irresponsibility. They have been ahistorical in their approach to the problems of that other African, you know, countries or citizens of other African nations are facing in South Africa. Ahistorical in the sense that if there was any country that would be guilty of this kind of thing, it is not South Africa, that had to depend on the solidarity of other African countries to set South Africa free as a country. You know, so that really is unfortunate. But again, it is not just a Nigerian situation. So you cannot talk about a unitary solution to the problem of, xenophobia in South Africa. There must be a multilateral approach.
Of course, we have Ghana, for instance, reporting South Africa.
There must be a multilateral approach because it has become an African issue. Citizens of other African countries have been at the receiving end of this level of embarrassing, intolerable, and bestial behavior on the part of citizens of South Africa. There is no justification, so we don't even want to go to the reasons. And just like Malaki also pointed out, the very lame, you know, excuse, and the most unfortunate and undiplomatic excuse given by the South African president himself, justifying, while condemning in one breath, in the other breath, he upholds the reasons for what is going on in South Africa, the reasons for the murder of African, you know, citizens that are under normal circumstances supposed to be under the sanctuary of the South African government. So it does not even matter whether some of them have, you know, do not have rights, legal rights to be in South Africa or not. But the reality is that the South Africa, the fact that they are already there, they have a duty and a responsibility to protect every human life in South Africa. So I would expect, again, a multilateral approach to what is going on. I would expect, and that, again, is going to bring to the fore the ability of the African Union that a lot of people for so long have tended to dismiss with a wave of hand as a toothless bulldog. You know, the ability to be in a position to impose not just severe warnings but severe sanctions on the South African government. They must be able to do that because, just like you have always said, the first one that took place in South Africa was unfortunate. The second one was an embarrassment. The third one was a failure, clearly, of the South African government to do their part in protecting and securing the lives and properties of everybody in South Africa, not just the immigrants.
Are you confident the EU person. Can deal with this?
No, I'm not exactly confident. A lot of people have described the EU as a conglomeration of, well, it's as a boys' club, more or less. You know, I'm not exactly sure. They have not been able to deal with situations that confront the African continent, especially when these situations have to do with fellow governments in the African continent. But I think that they should be angry enough. They should know that the South Africans have run out of excuses. And I want to believe that on the basis of that they must realize that at this particular point in time, that if there is no serious sanction, no serious punishment that will be inflicted on South Africa itself, in terms of going after, not just at the diplomatic level, you know, but in terms of going after strategic interests of the South African government outside of South Africa in a way that we pinch
economy. Should we say these various governments too should, you know, the governments involved now should go after the strategic interest of South Africa, say, for instance, Nigeria? Because if, for instance, we know that the AU might find it difficult to actually act in this case, that these various governments too who have been affected can actually, because you look at it, South Africa has got some strategic interests in some of these countries. Take Nigeria, for instance. South Africa has got some strategic interests here.
Can I quickly make this point before Malaki comes in? The reality, I agree that Nigeria has lost its respect in the international community, no doubt. Nigeria is not as big as she used to be. This is not the Nigeria that pulled out of the Commonwealth, you know, games, for instance, and virtually every other country in Africa followed suit because Nigeria had that kind of clout. And the reality is that in international relations, you can only give what you have. You have to have strength at home, domestically. And it is that strength you have at home that you project in the international arena. Nigeria, unfortunately, is not able to project that kind of strength anymore. But even in spite of that, Nigeria is still a country that you cannot look away from in terms of the size, in terms of the economy and all of that. So Nigeria can play a role in leading other African countries, especially those ones that are the receiving end of what is going on now, in leading them in whatever action that they can take against South African government.
Well, I was going to add, and I thank you for the last point you made because you got your fingers properly around the issues. To respond by committing the same offense perpetrated in South Africa will not be a solution to the crisis at hand. I mean, if you condemn an incident, reason requires that you should rise above that particular category of offense, just so that you show what the example ought to be. And in that wise, the idea of reprisal, you know, will not be accommodated in any form. I like to insist that what we are discussing could be immediate reaction, you know, in the realms of immediate reaction to this very disturbing trend. But in the long run, Nigeria must look hard at the socio-economic conditions that has created and driven our people away from the shores of this country. That must be the long-term approach to secure and restore the dignity of our people. No doubt, a number of outcasts in our society get out of this environment to perpetrate one crime or the other in foreign countries. But the majority of them have been forced to leave this country, believing that the grass is greener on the other side of the fence. And so the question of what leads this mass exodus, not only to South Africa, even in very funny banana countries now, inclusive of seeking for education, seeking for minimal survival and all that. Benin Republic, and so on and so forth. It is time for the present government to, have a serious blueprint, have a serious talk with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. It used to be the foreign policy used to be that Afrocentric, you know, focusing on Africa. But factors have conspired over the decades to show that we have more immediate challenges, at least to even be able to project, like my colleague said, what our agenda on the world space would be. So, to what extent can we begin to integrate into governance, as it were, those projects and activities that will enable survival, that will make survival a possibility here in Nigeria, just so that you reduce the incidence of the kind of misconception. And it is not peculiar to South Africa. Part of the reasons why Donald Trump was able to sway the minds of the white voters is that your jobs have been taken away by immigrants. No matter how funny that sounds, as a country that is founded on immigrants, to speak with. So I have made that point that it is important, very important, perhaps urgent now, that beyond condemning this, the Nigerian government must find a way to retrieve the confidence of the Nigerian people that is already lost, must find a way to practically give value to existence in the country and take proactive steps to ensure that you would understand that it is even better, much as such transborder commercial activity or business activities may be desirable. you are better off if you focus your energy around here and deal with the world as you relate with them. You know. Secondly, I imagine that it would be of strategic importance too if the Nigerian government is able to exert its power. And there are several ways of doing it. A country such as ours, with the resources that we have, including population, can take one or two exemplary steps, either economic in nature or political, by way of sanction.
Because we just need to send a strong message that Nigeria cannot continue.
Take Benin Republic, for instance. If the border between Benin Republic and Nigeria is closed, that country suffocates. And I'm saying that there are other aspects of our interaction with the South African government that will send a signal to South Africa that, look, it's high time you stopped toying with the lives.
Yeah, exactly. And because you see, when you deal with the business interests.
Because that impression has been created that, you know, it's like the government, Nigeria can't do anything anyway.
Yeah, you know,
it's like the South African government is looking at us.
As an inconsequential.
The thing is that once you go after their business interests, it's not just the government that's feeling it. Businessmen are feeling it in South Africa, powerful businessmen. They have invested so much money abroad, and now they are losing this money as a result of the inability of the government to do the right thing. So it is these business interests that are going to put pressure on the government to protect their businesses abroad. And the only way they can do that is to protect those businesses abroad at home, starting from the home, because that is what is causing all of the problems. And that is what is expected that the government, like I said, first time unfortunate, second time embarrassing, third time, there's no excuse that this is happening, because we have seen it coming.
And if nothing is done, this is still going to happen.
Yeah. And it gives you, you know, a very serious, you know, a serious idea, or most unfortunately, about the nature and character of the people that are running South Africa today, in terms of the leadership of South Africa, the ANC in power, and then unfortunately President Zuma. He has been there, he was there when the last attack took place, made promises, said all kinds of things and so on. Obviously, that nothing has been done as a result of that. But again, you know, like I was saying, you know, before now, the reality is that even the excuses that are being given for what is going on too is misplaced. I mean, if you're talking about jobs that are not there, if you talk about the economic situation in South Africa, it's a government issue. But beyond that, again,
but the people are not targeting their government. They're taking out their anger on
85% of major businesses in South Africa are owned by the whites. I mean, they talked about the need for equality in South Africa. They talked about the need to reduce inequality in South Africa after the ANC came to power in 1999. It is an indictment on the inability of the ANC to, you know, project all of those things that they had promised the South African people. They have not reduced poverty. You know, there's growing poverty in South Africa. The issue of land, about 85% of white South Africa.
This provides a perfect excuse for the ANC and the government, you know, excuse for its failures. Yeah,
and that is why even before now, a lot of people in South Africa, within South Africa, have been saying that some of these things that are going on are politically motivated. And there have been accusations and counter-accusations about the ANC in some place trying to stoke up this. And it is not in an unusual situation. We have been, even in Nigeria and some other countries, parochial sentiments, primordial sentiments are sometimes used as a basis to try to get people away from facing the issues that are on ground. You know, religious issues, tendencies tend to create crisis sometimes in countries as a basis by the political leaders to divert attention from the real issues that confront the people. Because the day people begin to ask them the major, you know, questions, why are we in this situation? Why is the economy in this situation? Why do we not have access to land and the rest? Then they know they're going to be in trouble. So why not create a situation where people are going to say, well, it is not exactly the government, but, you know, we are in the situation we are in now because our borders are open for all kinds of people to come in and sell their jobs.
Because you look at it, the attackers are foolishly creating the impression that if the foreigners go, all of their problems will be solved. Jobs will be provided. Poverty will disappear.
Even if you are going to be led by the nose on account of such fallacy, it wouldn't detract from the point that human lives are extrajudicially exterminated. Exactly. Therefore, what is this society all about, talking about South Africa with a history, if in the vent of such
crisis. We've not heard of any prosecution at all.
We've not heard of any conviction.
I'm talking of conviction
because this was not the first time. This is not the first time. It wasn't the second time. There was a preceding incident, very ugly indeed. The way you deal with such a situation is to create the deterrence that will point as a reference point where any other person is inclined to doing the same. Don't forget, the business of impunity strives when nothing happens, when a transgression is committed. And so we're calling on the South African government, one that is expected to be grateful to Nigeria as a country, one that is expected to treat us and the Nigerian state and its citizens with some degree of respect as a major partner in their long struggle to retrieve their identity. And therefore, such an opportunity, a concrete opportunity like this, having identified some of the culprits, will be a veritable concrete opportunity to charge people to court and to say that, look, whether Nigerians, South Africans, Namibians, or wherever, you cannot continue to run a country that tolerates spontaneous extermination of lives and then deal with it as if there is a way to rationalize that. I mean, there are laws, and those laws should be invoked and then put in practice just so that we begin to set the deterrence.
Well, I'm afraid we have to end on that note. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for coming on the program. And it's an ugly incident. Let's just hope the killings stop, the attacks stop, and
Nigeria revives its economy.
Yes, Nigeria revives its economy so that, you know, honestly, as you said, the grass is not greener over there anyway. Every day, every hour, and every minute, news break in Nigeria. Things happen so fast, it's most times difficult to track and comprehend them. But that's what we do right here on DEJI360. 2015, would you want to come back again?
It's like asking Jesus Christ if he knew he was going to die, will you come? Will you want to come back as the savior of the world again?
We do not just help you track the stories, we break them down. Explore all the angles, analyze the issues so that you can fully comprehend the stories and use them to make the right decisions.